Right, welcome everyone to the Boiler Room Ballantine Stream Music Forum in Valencia, in sunny Spain. We're here, we've got obviously a bunch of talks, we've got a party tomorrow called Hybrid Sounds, and the theme of that is producers kind of collaborating and working with musicians, and there's probably no better person to talk about that than this guy here. He's no stranger to Boiler Room, he's done a few now, he's done Way Back When, which was like a chilled hip-hop soul set, which is probably one of the most popular Boiler Room times of all time. It's got millions of views. He actually played a Ballantine's party in Brazil amongst Brazilian musicians and house legend Todd Terry and Giles Peterson. And then he also just played a few months ago at an event in Sheffield where celebrating 30 years of Sheffield techno. And I guess even just with his Boiler Rooms, it kind of shows the range of hip-hop, soul, reggae, dub, house, techno. So we're going to speak to him, go through some of his productions, and get to know this guy's sound. So Valencia, make some noise for Nightmares on Wax, please.
Thank you. Nice intro.
You're used to this sunny sun, aren't you? Ibiza-based. So we were going to go straight into your album, but I stopped you and insisted that we started at the very beginning with basically your first ever track.
Yeah, the first track. Well, I've got to give a shout out to my original partner, Kevin Boy Wonder Harper, who started out with me. And this track was originally inspired by a guy called Gerald, Voodoo Ray. I remember at the time hearing Voodoo Ray come out, and you know, we were in this crew battle thing with Manchester, with Sheffield and Huddersfield and all these places around us. You know, that if when somebody from a crew drops a track, it means that we need to drop a track. And
Yorkshire beef.
Yorkshire beef, Northern beef. But you know, we came from a breaking background, you know, breakdance crews, just like Gerald did. Just like Winston Hazel did and all these people. Thank you. And
he gets a drink, I don't, I guess, the celebrity.
Yours is there. And
My bad. Thank you, Ballantines.
And basically, Gerald dropped his track, which we were all like, wow, this is amazing. We need to make a tune. And I think the version we're going to play is the version that we actually remixed for Warp. Because we originally brought it out on our own label, which was famously called Poverty Records. Not a great name for a record label. So I think this version is the remix version that we did when we signed to Warp in September 1989.
Yeah, this was actually the second ever Warp release, wasn't it?
Yes.
Sandwich before that was Forge Master. Track with no name.
Yeah.
And then after that, LFO.
Yeah.
Guy called Gerald, Sheffield Techno, that kind of, it must have been, like, was it, for me, when I hear of these tracks, they're iconic tracks of a particular era. When you guys were doing this, did it feel like that, or was it just mates having a laugh? Because it's influenced electronic music even to this day.
I think every person that was involved in that movement at that time would feel like, you know, within reggae and sound system culture, you have this dropping of dub plates and everybody has their own dub plate. That was the way we were coming from. Do you know what I mean? Because your track represented your crew. Do you know what I mean? So it was just like, they've come with that, we need to come with this. Do you know what I mean? And literally, that was happening literally nearly every 2-3 months up north. Do you know what I mean? And next person was coming with a track. So all of a sudden we were like, especially with the raves that were happening, we were like, we're part of a movement here. There's something happening here, you know what I mean? So it was crazy exciting.
Should we listen to the track?
We shall do. Have you queued it up?
Should be.
Here we go. This is Dextrous.
1989. Now loading. Come on, CDJs. Let's do this. Come on, mate, I thought you were a DJ.
Me? Not today.
Yeah. proper Northern techno, eh, lad? Nice. 1989.
I also have to mention that the engineer involved at the time on this track was a guy famously known as Rob Gordon.
He also did Forge Masters, like he did a lot of the early Warp stuff.
Yeah, because I mean, like when me and Kevin originally made that song, we made it on a four-track cassette deck.
This must be one of the first songs you've ever made, no?
Well, it wasn't, but... It was the first time we'd had the opportunity to go into a real studio. Do you know what I mean? So we'd done everything else at home on a four-track cassette recorder, and Roland SH-101 keyboard, and we borrowed somebody's 808 drum machine. That's how we originally made that track. And then I had a little Casio SK-1 sampler, which we sampled. On the original version that I'm talking about, we actually sampled Gerald's track.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like sneakily in the background. So, but I want to give a shout out to Rob Gordon, because Rob Gordon sonically helped us bring it to another level with his engineering, but also allowing us to use his equipment.
And you've been on Warp ever since, actually. The 30 years, you've gone through many different... I was actually looking at the discography. The first three... of the first 10 Warp releases was you.
Yeah.
And you're probably the only artist who's consistently...
Still here.
still around, which is quite an amazing testament to have gone through so many different styles and longevity, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a crazy journey, and it still is a crazy journey. It still amazes me where music takes me, and still amazes me the fact that I have this relationship with it, and I still have this hunger and excitement that goes with it.
What's the secret of lasting 30 years and still having a career with it? Not many people do that.
I think sticking to your guns. I think that's really, and that's not the easiest thing to do, because there's always things around you that, and people around you that are telling you, oh, you should try this, you should do that, but really sticking with your guns. It's not all been rosy, do you know what I'm saying? There's been times when there's been lots of lulls, do you know what I mean? But I think that all that is part of the discovery, and all that's part of like trying to find out what this relationship is with the craft that you're in, or what you know, or even just recognizing that you have a craft. That takes time, you know.
Yeah, the first track we played is quite of that kind of Northern techno, you know, Yorkshire, Sheffield era, but you've kind of always had hip hop as a base throughout, really.
Yeah, I mean, it was hip hop. Even Kevin will say, my original partner will say, that it's hip-hop that even brought us to the table with making music, because it was hip-hop that made us realise that, you know, that we could dismantle something and make something else. You know, you can take something apart and make something else out of it, you know what I mean? It's just that mentality was created through hip-hop. So I believe that, you know, like, hip-hop is anything and everything that ever influenced it, do you know what I mean? And I believe that our approach, doesn't matter whether it's house music, doesn't matter what genre of music it is, it's still a hip-hop mentality that is approached in there, you know?
And were you a b-boy?
I am.
You used to actually like dancing?
I am.
Okay. And then bust some moves in. Don't say that.
You've got to get the tequilas out, man.
What's the next track that you're going to...
So the next track is a track called Salbatardis, which is actually another version of Aftermath, which was our follow-up single to Dextrous, which was kind of like obviously quite a big club track and charted, did a national chart, which was really weird for us at the time. But we were experimenting with sounds as far as, like, so we talk about the sample attitude and stuff, and the hip-hop attitude going into production. And the reason why I picked this track out is because, even though it is another version of Aftermath, what happened, I remember me and Kevin were in the studio and we were messing about with I think it was an Akai S950 sampler, and we were using a Korg. A Korg M1, and something really weird happened. It started to trigger the samples that we had in there on this track, and we were actually originally working on Aftermath, but what came out of it was this track.
It was like a total accident.
So you might be able to hear it in the sample. It sounds really cleverly sampled, but I guarantee you a lot of it's an accident.
Nice, let's have a listen.
So this is Salbatardis.
This is 91.
No, this is 1990 when we made this. So it was obviously digging into the Ultimate Breaks and Beats library, digging samples out and stuff. As you hear where the snares are and the way the snares behave, it's totally hip-hop, really. But we were going against the grain because we were coming from this, like I said, b-boy sort of attitude
in the
background and breakbeats and stuff, which people didn't even call it breakbeats back then. Do you know what I mean? So even the album that this was on, A Word of Science, at the time, the things that we were experimenting with was... Well, we went into that album saying that we're going to do everything that's ever influenced us, which meant we dug into all our record collections and we just threw everything at an album because we weren't too sure if we'd get a chance to do an album again, you know? So within that album, you've got like drum and bass, what they call drum and bass now, what you call breakbeat now, you know, what people call in techno now, but we didn't have any of that language at the time, you know? We were just making music for, you know, for the dance floor and from the background that we had there, you know?
How is that as a challenge? I think it's a challenge that producers as a whole throughout electronic music, that transitioning from being an artist that releases 12 inches, one track each for the dance floor, to actually doing a proper album that feels rounded and not just a collection of, which is something that I probably is a reason that you have lasted this long, because you've made proper albums that people have connected with.
Yeah, I would say that the first album was the easiest. It was the easiest.
Really?
I would say the first album was the easiest to make because it
no
was
expectations.
Like...
No expectations.
Well, yeah, because it's like, what, you want us to make an album? Do you know what I mean? And we were like, yeah, we'll do that. So we were like, you know, got remember, we were like 19, man. Do you know what I mean? And we were just like, let's just throw this at it. Let's try this. Let's do it. There was nothing stopping us. There was no... We weren't trying to achieve any acclaim for anything. We just wanted to just... We just had this, like... blank canvas to do what we wanted. Do you know what I mean? And thanks to Warp, we had that blank canvas as well. You know, so I actually believe that it was the easiest album for us to make. It was probably the hardest album for us to release.
Why?
Because it wasn't really received. You know, like people didn't get it. People didn't understand it. And that's the gospel truth. People didn't understand it. And it wasn't until like 4 or 5 years later, people started coming up to him going, yo, that album's this, that album's that. Yeah. And it's just like, where were you 5 years ago?
Yeah. And do you think, you say it's the easiest album to make, do you think that because with each album comes more expectation and pressure to deliver?
Yeah, well, you're just searching. I think that every album you make, you erase something. Do you know what I mean? You erase, because you don't want to repeat. You don't want to, an album is a reflection of where you're at. Do you know what I mean? And it's like we called the album A Word of Science, First and Final Chapter. A Word of Science because it was an experiment. First and Final Chapter because there'll be never anything like it again. We knew that. Do you know what I mean? Like, so, you know, and then there was a different transition, like when Kevin, you know, we parted ways and stuff after we did a few more singles after that. And then I went in to do Smoker's Delight. That was something I was already making in the background of this album. So that's why you can hear traces of Smoker's Delight in A Word of Science, because I was going to do that as a solo project originally. You know, so, and that was something I was making for me and my friends anyway. That's what Smoker's Delight was. This was us listening to my samples and my loops after a rave and going back to somebody's house or after
chilling
a
out.
Gig. you know, or in a chalet at Southport Weekender, we'd be listening to my samples, you
it's
know?
Basically, it's that, it's kind of how that album has reached that kind of iconic level of being used for that purpose.
Yeah, I mean, that, even the album is like, you know, when people come up to me and mention the album, they explain stories to me, but they're the stories that mirror the stories that I have with my friends.
Yeah.
You know, every song on the album is related to a certain time and a certain place with my friends and my crew from Leeds. So it's quite amazing that them people are having their experiences in their own way with the album. Nobody could have predicted that or even imagined that. Not that, like, literally nobody, you know?
Yeah. Can we quickly talk about, we're gonna about to go into like a trio of songs that run yeah. across your first three albums, but one thing about Nightmares and Wax is you are Nightmares and Wax, but almost with every album there's different collaboration processes yeah. and different people you work with. Can you tell me a little bit about the mindset and thinking of why you do that?
Well, I mean, like, literally, like I say, from the beginning it was me and Kevin producing beats and samples and doing stuff together, and then we made a couple of house tracks, a track called Set Me Free and a track called Happiness. And we brought in an incredible keyboard player by the name of Robin Taylor Firth, who was introduced to us via Steve at Warp and Parrot. He was doing some stuff with Parrot. We started to build a relationship with Robin in the beginning. You know, and like I say, and then that was the first sort of like involvement. We were working with a live musician, you know, like a keyboard player and stuff like that.
Was it a difficult transition?
It wasn't a difficult transition. He could play chords that we could play. Yeah. We could, you know, we got, remember, we were guys like that were experimenting and making beats and doing stuff. We didn't know anything about chord changes or, you know, like things being in key, or this just wasn't even in our world. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. We were just like, let's just do that. It wasn't like, but then you come to a point where we're like, oh, you're going to work with a vocalist now, so we need to make some things like not so discordant and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean? So, and Robin, I learned so much from Robin. So much from Robin. And like, as Robin got involved with them tracks, me and Robin deeply got more involved in the Smoker's Delight. But the reason why we're going to go into these three songs now is that on the first album, A Word of Science, there's a song called Night's Interlude. And it famously samples Summer in the City by Quincy Jones. Yeah.
Quincy Jones must love you because you sampled him three times in a row, right?
Well, no, we only sampled it twice. Basically, I'll tell you the story and then I'll give you the rundown. So basically, on the first track, Night's Interlude, which is on A Word of Science, is 100% sampled. 100% chopped up of Summer in the City. Then in the second version, which is on Smoker's Delight, which is Night's Interlude, I involved Robin and we created the string arrangement, which became part of that track. And then through the success of Smoker's Delight, Rob Mitchell, bless his soul, from Warp says, you should do an orchestrated version, right? And then like, we were just like, yeah, but we need to clear this. We need to get, like, because we'd done it kind of a bit gangster in the beginning, and we approached...
Were the samples... I'm going to get people in... But the sample's not cleared.
In trouble. So originally, I'm going to hold hands up, originally the sample wasn't cleared. Second time round, we cleared the sample, but the only way I could clear the sample, this is what we got told from the publisher of Quincy Jones, is that you need to explain why you're using it. So I had to write a letter to Quincy Jones.
That's pretty gangster. What did you say?
I just
please, Quincy.
I just basically told the truth, which is how much of a mentor he is, and the history of his life and his journey in through music has been a massive inspiration for me. This is a producer that, even when all the scenes and all the trends were changing around him, he just stuck to his guns and just traveled all the way through it. He even left his country to go like play in underground jazz clubs in France while all the doo-wop shit was going on. You know what I mean? Like, but he stuck to his guns.
He is basically the ultimate producer.
Yeah.
Like,
so
the way he put musicians together. And...
Yeah. So I told him what he didn't know, how amazing he is.
Yeah.
But basically we managed to clear the sample, and then through Lenui, we went and we decided through the string line that we'd written with Robin, We went to Angel Studios in London and we recorded with a 52-piece orchestra, the string arrangement of Lenui. So I'll give you a couple of minutes of each.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep. Yep.
So the moment you hear this, you'll all remember this one.
This is the slowly loading sample-based one.
We're doing it chronologically.
Indeed. Years prior.
Cook, Quinta. I want to talk about this because a lot of people will know this sample from Far Side.
Exactly.
Like an ultimate hip hop track. But you actually did it first.
Exactly.
Same shop. Have you ever met Far Side and talked about it?
I have met Far. Well, I met Fatlip, but it wasn't in a very conversational state. We were in Amsterdam, so
yeah.
It wasn't the time.
But did they must have heard your flip and then...
You know what, I don't know. I mean, the amount of times, like, even now in a tour and if we involve this in our set, people go, oh man, you played that Far Side sample. And I'm like, yeah, okay.
It's like Ray J, I hit it first.
But, you know, I mean, like, I remember at the time of putting this together, when I first discovered this track, it was in 1987. And I didn't have a sampler. And I used to keep it up on a shelf. And I said, one day, because the sampler...
Oh, the Quincy Jones record.
Yeah, because I remember, like, I was thinking, one day, I'm going to have a sampler. I'm going to be able to sample the whole thing. Because the sampler I had, I could only get, like, 1.2 seconds. And I couldn't spin the record quick enough to get the sample. So it was always one day. And then when I got the Akai S950 and I sampled it, that was just like, people talk about chops now. I didn't even know what that was, but that's like, that whole track is made up of chops of that song, you know?
Yeah.
So the evolution of that then goes on to Night's Interlude. Double check that's loaded right. There we go. Which is when we involved Robin Taylor Firth on keys. And we, I remember Kevin was involved in this track. Me and Kevin were still together at the time. So it was like, it was kind of just floating in between projects at the time. But I remember when we made this track, me and Kevin used to catch the coach from Leeds every day to the studio in Sheffield. And I remember us coming back and we had us, you know, Walkmans, as cassette Walkmans, because it's that long ago. And I remember we listened to it about 10 times on the way back and we were just like, we made a baby today. This is our baby. Gives you a little demo of the influence of using a live musician on keys and the transition of the track there. And then
do you find it more enjoyable just you working on the beats, or do you enjoy the process of having someone else input into the
No, to be honest with you, I always put myself away for a bit because I know I can go deeper if I'm on my own. But then I also love the interaction of being with musicians in a room. And especially because I'm very fortunate, I work with a lot of high-level musicians. And my mission is always to give them a massive challenge. So I've been in situations where, you know, I play with like an amazing guitarist and he's just like, yeah, I know what you're trying to get me to play, but you're trying to get me to play it wrong, but it sounds amazing. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because I'm not musically trained at all. I have no training whatsoever. I just go on what I feel and what I feel and what I can hear. So I love that. I love being in that situation where you are challenging somebody in some sort of way, because then it brings magic out, you know?
Yeah. Has it ever been gone wrong where the musician's like, that's musically not correct, I'm not doing it, and it's turned into a bit of friction?
Never.
Normally works out.
Never. If it has, they never told me.
I think I listened to a podcast of you recently, you were talking about Andrew Ashong, and you were just trying to be like, no, it's got to be like this. And
then at 5 a.m.
He was like, oh, okay, I get it.
Yeah. I forgot about that moment, yeah. Yeah, that was me just trying to get, because as well, so it's language as well, you know, like you can use certain language when you're just like when you're having a conversation with somebody, but you can use certain language when you're in the studio, but it's just not connecting. It could be the same if you've got a vocalist in the booth and you try to get the singer, he or she, to represent in a certain way, and then bang, you say a certain word and it just clicks. Do you know what I mean? And the person does exactly the thing. Do you know what I mean? So sometimes it could just be a language thing, you know?
Should we, just to hear the involvement of this particular sample and, I guess, theme that ran through your first album, should we hear the orchestrated version of this Quincy Jones theme? It's such a different stretch away from the original. And so who played on this? Was it a full-on string section?
Yeah, the full string section were called Soul Strings from London. 52-piece.
52?
Yeah. Angel Studios, so
Warp had the budget then, because you were selling albums at 52p.
Well, you know what, Smoker's Delight helped pay for it.
Nice.
Put it that way. The fans that bought Smoker's Delight helped pay for it, put it that way. But no, I mean, like, I remember this, being in the studio this day and just seeing all these people in the room, and literally, obviously, you have the fixer and the arranger that scores the music. And these people have not even heard the song.
Did you wear a little tux?
I'm not that gangster. but like, just to see all these people walk in the room, look at their sheets, and just play. Like, you've not even heard the song yet. It's just like, but these people are so professional, so amazing at what they do. The most challenging thing about working with any string arrangement is feel. It's because anybody can play what's in front of them, you know, they can read it, but can they get the feel? And I remember we had to do 2 or 3 takes to get them to just sit back on it, to really get the feel on it. And I think that's the most challenging thing when it comes to working with that many people in one room, you know? Gone from like pure samples to now everything that's in this track is played. The beat's obviously programmed by me. The vocal sample is Sarah Winton on vocals, so we sampled her on vocalist. We basically just took the whole thing, because what happened at that time with Nightmares and Wax, because we were touring and promoting Smoker's Delight, I put a band together and took that tour on the road. And that made me realize that I looked around on stage and I'm working with these amazing musicians that I could sample my own musicians. I don't have to sample records. And that just changed, totally flipped the thing in my production.
Makes it easier on your publisher's life as well.
That as well, but then what I did, because I still, you know.
Just quickly before we move on, the ironic thing about this is probably furthest away from the original sample.
Yeah.
But actually the first two kind of sound like hip hop beats in feel and emotion. This is probably closest to Quincy Jones' Summer in the City.
Exactly. The more orchestrated vibe and the more... Well, the thing is, going to the things that I'm attracted to when I'm sampling and going into that kind of production, like I said, working with these musicians has totally just changed my mindset on the way to produce and write with tracks. You know, so I might get a sample and I look at that sample and I look at what I can get the musicians to recreate, rebuild the whole structure around what the musicians are doing and take the sample out. I don't even use the sample.
Do you not sample anymore?
So I do sample, yeah, but I use the inspiration more. Do you know what I mean? And just having that mindset, it just takes you into a different creative world when it comes to making music and doing production.
Yeah. So we're gonna have a bit of time for questions and answers. So if you guys think of your questions, but we're gonna go bring it up to modern day with your latest album, basically, which again you've worked with a lot of different musicians and.
Yeah, I mean, what have we got here? We'll go with the edited version, because I believe we're running out of time. So this next track is off my latest album, which is called Shape the Future. This is a song called Back to Nature. And this involved some field recording.
I've noticed that every track you've picked, well, except listen, it's the first track of the album. Do you always first strongest foot forward with each album, your favourite track?
And to be honest, I was just going more with what you guys wanted to talk about. And I just... I just thinking about the aspects of recording and putting music together, you know, like, what have you done differently in your production? Do you know what I mean? And the reason why I've chosen Back to Nature is because some of this is recorded in the jungle in Mexico, when I was in a peyote ceremony. The others, the actual dialogue and the spoken word that's in it was recorded in conversation with a shaman that I work with called Quietly Vasquez. And then I worked with a composer called Sebastian Studeninski from Berlin, and with some string players from there as well. So, and you've gone more back, even though this is on the latest album, I feel like the methods that I've used this is more in the zone of Smoker's Delight.
Yeah.
You know, so I kind of wanted to show the marriage between that. You know, and there's obviously a nice, powerful, strong message in there.
All humans share one spirit. All humans share one consciousness. But yet they want to be separated. Like my ideas. They don't realize that all humans share a huge pool of consciousness, of thought. All human thought vibrates at a certain frequency. We're all in communication. You know, when you exhale, I breathe the air you breathe. We're all together, really. This is the way nature designed it. So that we will be sharing the earth together.
This is field recordings and these kind of shamanistic rituals and I don't really know what to call them, but do you, obviously spirituality and that sort of connection is something that's important to you. Do you ever create music while on these, you know, I don't know how to call it. Is it chemicals or these?
What do you mean, like
these potions?
Potions. I've written music and been influenced on the wonderful sacred medicine of peyote, yeah, and I'm very grateful for that. Very grateful for that. So yeah, I mean, like, the medicines have shown me, and these some of the ways that I've been shown from the people that I've held space with has definitely changed my life and definitely opened me up to a lot of beautiful creative things. And my approach has made me realize that when I'm DJing, it's a ceremony. When I'm making music, it's a ceremony. You know, that to be aware of the space that you're in, doesn't matter what you're doing, if you're aware of the space you're in and you're grateful in that space, you can project a lot of good things.
Even your approach to music making, it's quite worldly. Even the album was recorded in different parts. Like, some was obviously in Ibiza, but didn't you record some in, like, where you're from?
In Leeds, yeah, I went back to Leeds, recorded with my homeboy LSK, with Chris Dawkins. LSK was on the Mind Elevation album, 70s, 80s. Yeah. He's on the album, he's on the track Tomorrow. I recorded with Chris Dawkins, who's played guitar on my album since Smoker's Delight all the way through. I just felt I needed to go back to Leeds. I was working on this album and I was just like, I need to go back to Leeds. It just came to me. I came back off holiday and I was meant to be finishing my album at home, and I was just like, you need to go to Leeds. So I went to Leeds, spent 3 days there, worked with JD73 and just some, you know, Leeds people. Just to feel that city energy, you know, because it's great making music in Ibiza and writing music in Ibiza, but you need to feel the city, you know. Yeah. And it's taken me a while to notice that, realize that, but you need to feel the city because
to
the
get
city.
That edge.
Gives you an energy. Like, I can listen to a demo, like, in a car as soon as I land in Leeds, and I know exactly what's wrong with it.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is. You just, you know what I mean? It just gives you something. So I felt I needed to reconnect with that. But also, like, a lot of the people that I've worked with, it's all happened organically. You know what I mean? And like, I have a lot of, like, appreciation to be able to go into a space with these people that I've worked with and to be able to connect in that certain way, because it's all right saying, oh, you'd like to collaborate with this person on that person, but I need to, just as the other person does, you need to feel a connection. Do you know what I mean?
I've noticed some of the collaborators on the new album are people you invited to play at your party in Ibiza. Yeah. Do you tactically book people and then be like...
Never.
Oh, come round to my house for dinner and be like, oh, look, the recording studio is here.
Well, the Jordan Rakai...
Be honest with me.
The Jordan Rakai story is a funny story. Do you know what I mean? I don't know if Jordan finds it funny, but I think it's funny. So basically, Jordan Rakai came to perform at Wax a Jam a couple of years ago, and it was our closing party, and I normally do a barbecue afterwards back at my house. So we invited him and the band to the barbecue the next day. And so they came and it was just like, yo, come and check the studio out, blah, blah, blah. I've got a few beats here. Do you want to listen to some beats? Played him some beats. In the meantime, I'm trying to arrange the barbecue. I'm not cooking, but I'm trying to go get the gas and the da-da-da and all this stuff, the drinks. And Kazim, my manager's there, and he sat in the studio. And Jordan picked out a beat. And it was a beat that I'd had since 2006, right? And he's just like, yeah, yeah, I like that one. So I left him to it, went off and did all my things to sort the barbecue and the party out. And I came back and he'd already written the song. It was beautiful. And I was just like, wow, if you even knew the story behind this beat. And the beat, seriously, I've had for so long. And
he finished it.
Yeah, he finished it. Well, after that, I took it to Berlin, put strings on it, worked with my composer and all that sort of stuff. And we made the tune Typical. But... just the fact that...
Are you now tactically going to book people who you want for your next album and be like, oh, this is the recording studio, I had no idea.
It's a possibility.
What's the last track we're going to listen to?
So the last track is a track called Got a Smile. And basically the approach on this track is, like, I've been working quite a lot over my last two albums. I've been working quite a lot with a live drummer. On this one, I've got a drummer called Grant Kershaw. And my approach to this track is that I wanted it to be a little bit Balearic, but I also wanted it to feel, the drums to be more like, I can say, more of a salsa feel, yeah, on it. So, and it's got live keys on it by JD73, but it's also got, like, you know, my sample approach as well. So overall, what I'm trying to show you and share with you is the combination of all these elements together, because I've set myself the personal mission. And my personal mission is to create the perfect Malik. My mission is to set the perfect marriage between analog and digital. That's my mission. That's just for me personally. Now, what does that mean? That means, like, what I'm playing around digitally and what I'm manipulating digitally, but also what I'm doing from the analog point of view with live musicians and, you know, recorded in that way, and how can I bring them elements together and create the perfect marriage? And this is my attempt at that. There features Shovel on percussion, on guitar Chris Dawkins, and on drums Grant Kershaw, and obviously myself on beats and samples and stuff.
And you said your first album felt like the easiest to make, and this was your latest. What's like, how much harder is it to put this together? Is it because of all the added elements, all the other variables with musicians, or
the toughest part of this album for me was compiling it? Like, every other album is just kind of falling into place, and this album just wasn't like that. And you're probably going to laugh now, but the biggest help that I had compiling this album was iTunes Shuffle.
Really? Listening to other people's music? Or own tracks?
Putting all my tracks in and listening to them on iTunes Shuffle.
And seeing which order it works.
Yeah. And that's what helped me in the end.
Well, amazing. Right, we've got a little bit of time, we're overrunning slightly, but if there's any questions in the crowd, stick your hand up and someone will come around. That person in the white just there.
Hi. I was just wondering if you have a sort of process when you start making something. Like, do you have a kind of concept in your head and then think, how am I going to sort of get this down? Or do you kind of start going and an idea kind of forms out of that process, like push or pull?
It's different every time, to be honest. It could be like, for an example, I could have got a bass line in my head while I was waiting in an airport, and I've recorded that on my phone, and then I've gone back and I've like, let me work on that bass line, and I'll build from that and put a beat around it. Or it could be a sample.
Do you record into your phone, really?
Yeah, man, I get ideas in my head, so I record it into my phone.
Just hum it, or you've got a little
hum
app?
It. Yeah, okay. Just hum it into my phone. Yeah.
Interesting. So,
you got to remember to listen to back to them, but yeah, I've got lots of them in there. But yeah, it's different every time. You know, it's not like there's a set formulated process as it were. You know, but like, I like the idea of being totally free in what I'm going into, rather than going, I'm gonna do this. You know, the actual most exciting ways of going in the studio for me is when I don't have any plans to do anything at all. Is that I'll go in and I might start just messing about. Do you know what I mean? Or I'd go look at my record collection, I'll go, them, and I'll grab that bunch, and I'll drop a needle, and the first thing that catches me is the thing that I'll sample, and it's build something around that. But I don't know what style of track I'm making, I don't know what tempo it is, I don't know, do you know what I mean? I don't like, kind of like, because I don't feel that creativity works like that. Do you know what I mean? I feel that creativity comes, do you know what I mean? And you have to allow it to come in that way. Sometimes you do have a solid idea, but it's still inspired by something, you know?
So you never go and be like, right, I want to make techno, or I want to make hip hop, I want to make soul.
I might go, right, I'm going to make something to DJ with. I'm going to make a DJ tool. Do you know what I mean? But I still don't know what it is. I'm just going to go. Do you know what I mean? But like the Back to Nature track, that was two different ideas that became one. Yeah. Like originally I recorded the field recording of the shaman chanting in the jungle. And when he was chanting, I was lied in the jungle and I was like trying to count what he was chanting, and I couldn't count it because it was all over the place. And then that gave me the idea. I thought, imagine if he could orchestrate that melody. And that's what my original idea was.
Yeah.
But it never became that. It became a combination of the conversation I had with Quietly and the chant together.
Yeah. Interesting. Any more questions?
Yeah, we've got one from Facebook, which is particularly asking about George's influence on Car Boot Soul. What was the thing that inspired that?
The biggest influence on Car Boot Soul was the live musicians, because of, like I said earlier, from touring and doing Smoker's Delight, that tour made me realise I could sample my own musicians. So, and also, I had Smoker's Delight hanging over my head, because I was like, I can't make another concept album. Do you know what I mean? I need to break away. So I was like, there's going to be no interludes. Do you know what I mean? I'm going to put some songs on there. Do you know what I mean? That was like the only thing. I was just like, I need to make sure that it's separate. Do you know what I mean? So I think that's probably but I would definitely give the main nuts of it to actually going deeper with live musicians.
Do you think you'd ever go back to just you and you samples, drum machine?
Most definitely.
Yeah?
Yeah, most definitely. I've been doing some stuff lately now. Do you know what I mean? And I'm like, yeah, I'm kind of feeling that way right now at the moment, so...
I think things come in cycles, people...
They do, and like, I find it really interesting, like, the whole sample thing now, because, like, a lot of what people talk about, a lot of it's like, it's kind of what I was doing back in the days anyway, do you know what I mean? So I find that really, really interesting when people talk about chopping samples up and digging and this and that. It's just like something that I've always done, do you know what I mean? So, yeah.
We are running out of time, but if there's one more question or... Okay, we're going to wrap up. George, thanks so much. It's fascinating to kind of, well, we barely touched on it, but all the different styles that you've gone through for 30 years, and amazing that you're still producing, you know, such quality music through all these years, and so many people have come and gone in that era. Everyone make some noise for Nightmares and Wax, please.
Thank you.